Okay, so we've learned how to work with a file system. Now we're learning how to actually read and write actual files. So let's suppose we have a file like this, which we want to be able to read with our Python code. So we have just three simple lines of text in a file called demo.txt, and we want to read that. So what we're going to do is we're going to open up a file stream saying, let's read demo.txt, and we're opening it for reading. We could have left this part RT off. It will default to a text file and reading. And instead, just to, you know, in case you're having problems sometimes when you try to read files, you're never quite sure why it isn't working. Maybe the file isn't there. Maybe it's not readable. These are really common programming issues to run into. So you might do things like check and see if it's readable before you try to read it when you're trying to debug why you're getting an error. And then you can read one or more characters from the stream and then read to the end of a line. And then you can read all lines to the end of the file using read lines. So if I run this code, remembering this is the file we had, this is the end of the first line, second line, and third line. So if I run that code, what you're going to see is, and I'm just going to make this a little bit easier for you to see the whole thing at once. So is it readable? Yes, true. So that's a good sign. That's probably why the next few lines of code actually worked. And it reads one character, T. And then read to the end of a line, it continues. It doesn't reread the T. It continues from where we left off, and you know, is the end, is the first line of the file. And then when you see do the read lines, it continues again from where it left off and reads the second line of the file. And you'll see the new line show up as a new line character and then the last line of the file. So you can see all the values that get returned. Now, what if I want to write to a file? This also comes up a lot in different scenarios. Well, then we have to create a file and open it for writing. So this will actually create the file for me because the file doesn't exist yet. And again, we might want to just make sure that the file is created and it's writable before we start writing to it. So I'm just going to do a quick test and check if the file stream is writable before I start writing. And then I can write a single string. I can write multiple strings using write lines. So write, you pass it a string that you want to write. Write lines allows you to pass in multiple strings. And if you want a new line, you actually need a new line character. And I'm just going to comment this part out for now, and we'll come to that in just a second. So if I run this code, save those changes, go down here, and run the code. What's going to happen is it says, yes, I can write to this file. And over here on the left, look at that. It's created the output.txt file. And inside it, you can see hello world, because I wrote the H, and then I wrote ELLO, and then I said, now write a space, and now I write world, and then it inserted a nice new line for me. Now, what's really cool about using write lines is you can pass it multiple strings. And if you have something like a list object, maybe, anything that you can iterate over, if it contains strings, you can actually use write lines to say, take all the strings in that object that I can iterate over and write that to my file. So I can say, take the names Susan and Christopher. I might have that in a Python list, for example. And I can write all the names in the list to the file in one step. I don't have to write a loop to do this. It's such a slick little feature. So now if I write this again, run this code again, and now we open output.txt, you'll see Susan and Christopher written out. So both the names are written. Now, this is where I'm going to give you a little extra little cool thing. Because a lot of times when you're iterating through all the values in a list, you might want each value to appear on a separate line. So I'm going to show you a little trick that'll help you do that. One of the things you can do is, and I'm just going to start on a new line before I write Susan and Christopher, is you can use the join command. So when you're doing the write lines, you join a new line before each name. Now you could easily do commas if you need to make comma separated variable lists and so on. But in this case, I want each name to be on a new line. So the join command allows me to, after each value, include a new line with it. So now what you're going to see is in my output file, Susan and Christopher show up on separate lines. So that's a neat little trick that might make your lives easier when you're iterating through a list and using write lines. I just want to finish off by showing you another neat trick using seek. When you are writing to a file stream, and you write to a file stream, remember you're not actually writing to the file, you're writing to a file stream. And so you can actually move up and down around the file stream as you're writing to it. So if I decide to write the word demo with an exclamation mark, and then I use the seek command, seek allows me to reposition where I am in the file stream. So making seek 0 literally moves me to the beginning of the file stream. So then if I write again, it'll actually overwrite the first few characters with this new word. And then that'll so if I run that code, so you can see how it shows up in the output. Okay, now we see this manage.txt. You can actually see that the word demo, exclamation mark, the first four characters were overwritten by that word cool, but it still kept that exclamation mark from the word demo. So seek allows you to go back and overwrite parts of a stream. And I do just want to take a minute here to talk about flush and close. I explained this in the slide, so if you already heard it there, don't need to listen to it again. But those of you who jumped to the code, because I know some of you like to do that, flush, what it will do is it will take the contents of the file stream and write it to the actual file. So that way, if there's anybody else out there who's opening that file, they'll actually see your changes as well. Once you run that flush command, anyone else opening the file will see those same changes. But it doesn't actually mean it's necessarily saved to disk. The operating system will decide when to actually save those changes to disk itself. So just a small thing to be aware of. You don't have to call flush explicitly. When you call the close command to close your file, and that's something very important, you always want to close your files when you're done with them, file streams when you're done with them, that will automatically do a flush for you. So not a lot of reason to call flush explicitly, but it's a very common point of confusion. So I just wanted to explain what it does. Basically doing a flush by itself means take the contents of the file stream buffer, write it to the file. Doesn't mean it's saved to disk yet, just means it's in the file. So if anybody else is opening up that file, they'll see those changes. And it just sort of empties out the file stream if it's getting kind of big. All right, so some cool new things. Now you're ready to go start working with files.